بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com Your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
Then the Sheikh speaks about ruling with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. And this is a necessary and an essential result of La ilaha illallah and of having faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have two extremes nowadays. One extreme say that to reveal with the rule of Allah, this is tawheed, meaning that this is all tawheed. And when they call to tawheed, as they claim, they call to nothing but to this. And not only that, but they declare that calling people to stop worshipping the saints is not a priority now. We should delay this until we establish the rule of Allah. They say this. Amongst those who say this are the Ikhwan al-Muslimun, the leaders of Ikhwan al-Muslimun, whether in Egypt or in India. Hasan al-Banna said this. Sayyid Qutb says this so much. Maududi says this so much. And so many leaders. The other extreme, unfortunately, some people who attribute themselves to Salafiyah, and they are the ones whom we spoke about earlier, the ones who say that grave worshippers should not be called kafirs until the proof is established against and things like that. They also say something ugly regarding the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say that the rule with what Allah has revealed has nothing to do with tawheed. It is not from tawheed. And this is ignorance. This is pure ignorance. How could the ruling with the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be something which is very minor and is not from tawheed and things like that? This is ignorance. That's why the great scholars, when they put the fatwa against the two books of Halabi, amongst the points they said, and those books involved tahween amr al-hukum bima anzal Allah. That those two books involve belittling the position of ruling with the rule of Allah. So to say that this is not from tawheed, this is ignorance. And this is an extreme. Just like saying this is all the tawheed, this is another extreme. So we have two extremes. One says it is all the tawheed, and the other says it has nothing to do with tawheed. It is not from tawheed, and this and that. So those are extremes. The truth is that ruling with the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one of the branches of tawheed. It falls in tawheed al-rububiyya. It falls in tawheed al-uluhiyya. It falls in tawheed al-asma wa sifat. It falls in all forms of tawheed. It is an essential part of tawheed. Very essential. If you call people to stop worshipping the saints, it is equally important to tell them you should stop ruling with other than the rule of Allah. Except if you find the people ruling with the rule of Allah. But how could they be? If they are committing shirks, then they are not ruling with the rule of Allah. But anyway, we have two extremes actually. So the Sheikh here has put this kind of problem as the third chapter here or the fourth chapter, okay, which shows its importance. And the Sheikh says this is a necessary part of our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our submission to his rule and our pleasure with his sharia, to go back to his book and to the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam when we differ in any saying or in any ruling or in our disputes in matters regarding our bloods, our wealth and the rest of the duties. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of his names is Al-Hakam, and the rule goes back to him and belongs to him. So all the rulers should rule with what Allah has revealed. Then he mentions the verses. Number one is verse 58, Surah An-Nisa. Number two is verse 59, Surah An-Nisa. And then he says that faith cannot be combined with ruling with other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He mentioned the verse which is 60 from Surah An-Nisa. And then the fourth verse he mentioned was verse 65 from Surah An-Nisa. This last verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears that they will not believe until they make you, O Muhammad, the judge in all matters and disputes. This ignorant group that I mentioned earlier regarding the establishing the truth and belittling the position of the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they claim that this verse has nothing to do with the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know how do they understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think they are like Sufis who have zahir and batin. Zahir and batin means the apparent meaning is something, but there is a hidden meaning, okay? Now, what is the apparent meaning of this verse? It's nothing but the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is swearing by himself that they will not be believers until they make you, Muhammad, as a judge in all matters. So this is as clear as the sun that this regards the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What else could it be? They are making like the sheikhs of Sufis who say that this verse, which says aqimu salah, do not mean establish the prayer. It means respect the sheikh. Really, they say this. And the verse which says fast doesn't mean fast. It means keep the secrets of the sheikh hidden. They say this, okay? Fasting, siyam, is keeping the secrets of the sheikh. And establishing the prayer is to respect the sheikh, okay? This is their religion, okay? Now those people here come to this verse, which is very clear. It has nothing but the rule of Allah. And they say, no, it has nothing to do with the rule of Allah. It has nothing to do with the rule of Allah. Okay? The same thing. No difference. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that anyone who does not refer to the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's not a believer. And this is very clear. And then the three verses in Surah Al-Ma'idah, which are verses 44 to 47 from Surah Al-Ma'idah, which regard the rule of Allah. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. It's a must to rule with the rule of Allah and to take our judgments to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the book of Allah, to the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in all matters. Whatever matches the verses and sunnah, we should take. Whatever not match, we cannot take. And also the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 208, and the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 85. Also those who follow the madhabs, they have to refer to the book of Allah and the sunnah of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They take what the imam says and judge it with the Quran and Sunnah. You cannot give a priority to what the Imam says to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the truth is shown to you, then you cannot follow the Imam. But as long as you don't know the truth, no one has shown you that your Imam in this point is wrong, then you have the right to follow him. No problem with that. for a Hanafi person or a Shafi'i person to follow the madhab, what else could he do? He is a common man. Okay? But if he's shown the truth that your Imam said this, but this is not true. The truth is this, and this is the proof from Quran, this is the proof from Sunnah, this is the clear thing. Then he has no right to stick to his madhab. Because Imam Abu Hanifa said, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثُ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. Whenever there is a true hadith, then that is my madhab. Okay? That's why his direct students changed a lot of the madhab of their sheikh. Abu Yusuf took the madhab from Abu Hanifa and he changed one third of his madhab. He switched. Muhammad ibn al-Hasan switched two thirds of the madhab. He differed with his imam in two thirds of the madhab. Imam al-Shafi'i differed with himself. He in Mecca, he had a madhab. When he went to Egypt, he changed a lot, if not most of the madhab. That's why they say, al-Shafi'i said in al-Qadim, the old madhab. And then al-Shafi'i said in al-Jadid, the new madhab. Okay. Imam Ahmad, sometimes there are two narrations regarding a certain point, two narrations about him. One says this and one says different. Sometimes there are three narrations. Sometimes there are four. Sometimes there are five. Five different narrations. Okay? About one man. Why? Because they don't stick to their opinions. Imam Abu Hanifa said, don't write everything that I say. I might say something today from my opinion, and I back up tomorrow. And it was very easy for them to back up when the truth is shown to them. Because they were pious people. They feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have some ignorance nowadays who think that one should never back up. They take manhood to stick to the garbage when you know it's garbage. Okay? You stick to it. You don't change. Otherwise, you'll be muttarib. Person who is what? Shaky. Shaky. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in his book the verse which says, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم. This is verse 31, Surah At-Tawbah. Now this verse here regards ruling with the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the monks and rabbis, they were ruling with other than the rule of Allah. And their followers were taking their orders, even though they were ordering them with something different from the book of Allah. So Allah considered this to be a form of worship. When one Arab priest, before becoming a Muslim and following the Prophet ﷺ, Adi ibn Hatim, his father was Hatim al-Ta'i, very known in history. He was very generous. So this man, Adi ibn Hatim, was a priest. And he came with a cross on him, representing his tribe and his church. And he heard that this is the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he came to him. And he came to him with respect to follow him, actually. So when he came and he heard the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reciting this verse, they took their rabbis and monks as lords, said. So he understood this to mean that they were praying for their priests. So he said, O Muhammad, or O Messenger of Allah, we did not pray to them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, were not they making the halal haram for you and making the haram halal for you, and you were following them on that? He said, yes. He said, that is worshipping them. That is equal to worshipping them. So we have many people nowadays who don't know that this is worshipping a person. Whenever he makes something which is clearly haram, he makes it halal for you. Or something which is clearly halal, he makes it haram. And you accept it, then you are worshipping him. But if you act upon his order, which you know is different than Quran, and you admit that this is not true, but you acted upon it for some worldly gain, to follow your desire in something, okay? Let's say he is a king, and he told you, go and bring all the millions that Nadim has in his bank account. Just go and bring them, and take 1 million for you. Of course, in your heart, you know that this is not right. I cannot go and, but since there is 1 million for you, you go and do it, right? This is a sin. Even though you acted upon his order like this, this is a sin. This is not worshipping. This is a sin. So we should know this. Because unfortunately, the takfiris nowadays, they take verses like this and generalize it in a very ignorant way like this, you know. Not only this verse, but many verses. That's why they consider most of the people, of, if not all of the people, are kafirs, except few. You know, and this verse is not special for the Christians and Jews. Anyone can fall into this kind of worship or sin, because two levels, as Shaykh al-Islam explained. One level is worship, great shirk, and one level, which we mentioned about the millions of Nadim, this is not worship, this is a sin, because you know that this is stealing and not right. But you do it just for the sake of some wealthy gain, not believing in your heart that it is halal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the hypocrites that one of their qualities is that when they are called to the rule of Allah and His Messenger, they will turn away. They will turn away. This is the character of a hypocrite, and this kind of kufr here is not disbelief, it is turn away, i'rad. So the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kufr could occur by denying it or without denial, okay, without denial, but you turn away from the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you think it's more suitable for you or something like that. And you turn away from the rule of Allah and you accept the man-made rules as a substitute. You accept it as a substitute, not only act upon it, but you accept it as a substitute, even though you are not denying the rule of Allah. This is still kufr, great kufr. And the Shaykh then goes in, what is the ruling regarding he who rules with other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He brings the verse, he who rules with other than the rule of Allah, they are the kafirs. And then the Shaykh says, this kufr sometimes could be great kufr, which takes someone out of the religion. And sometimes it could be small kufr, which does not take someone out of the religion. And that is according to the situation of the ruler. Then the Shaykh makes this clear, saying, if the ruler believes that the rule of Allah is not a must, or he has a choice to rule with it or not, or belittles the rule of Allah and believes that other man-made laws are better than the rule of Allah, or that the rule of Allah is not suitable, or he wants to rule with other than the rule of Allah to please the kafirs and the hypocrites, then all this is great kufr. All this is great kufr. But if he believes that it is his obligation to rule with the rule of Allah, but the Shaykh says, في هذه الواقعة, in a certain incident, not as a general thing, in a certain incident, في هذه الواقعة, he chose otherwise, he chose other than the rule of Allah, in a certain situation, in a particular situation, he chose other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Adding to that, he admits that he deserves the punishment for this, then he is a sinner and he is committing a small kufr. And if he did not know the rule of Allah and he made his best effort to reach the rule of Allah, but he made a mistake, then he is a mujtahid and he is forgiven for this. Now the Sheikh says, وَهَذَا فِي الْحُكْمِ فِي الْقَضِيَّةِ الْخَاصَّةِ. This is regarding the rule in a particular or a special incident. القضية الخاصة. وأما الحكم في القضايا العامة. But regarding the law which is set as a general rule for people. Law which is set as a general rule for the people, then it is different. Then it is different. The situation is different. It's not a sin. It's not just a sin. Situation is different. Then he brings the quotation about Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah rahimahullah, which is in Majmu' al-Fatawa, volume 35, page 388. He says, if the ruler follows the religion, but he rules without knowledge, he will be amongst the people of hellfire. And if he was knowledgeable, but he rules with other than the truth that he knows, then he is still from the people of hellfire. But if he rules without justice and without knowledge, then he is more worthy to be amongst the people of hellfire. يعني he means by all this, his punishment will be hellfire. He doesn't mean he's a kafir. Then he says, and this is special of the incident for a person. Special for the qadiyya incident, a certain incident. But, Shaykh al-Islam says, but if he makes a general rule, وَأَمَّا إِذَا حَكَمَ حُكْمًا عَامًّا. If he makes a general or sets a general rule في دين المسلمين, in the religion of Muslims, and make the truth false and the falsehood truth, and turn the sunnah into an innovation and the innovation into a sunnah, and the ma'roof into munkar and the munkar into ma'roof, or the opposite, that is orders what Allah and His Messenger has forbidden, and the other one was forbids what Allah and His Messenger has ordered, then he says, Shaykh al-Islam says, فَهَذَا لَوْنٌ آخَرٌ يحكم فيه رب العالمين. This is a different thing. This is a different form. This is not like making a ruling in a special incident, the qadiyya. Okay. Now again, the contemporary, unfortunately, those who belittle the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Halabi and others, they say that the Shaykh al-Islam here does not mean that he who sets a general rule is kafir. يعني they clearly temper with the words of Shaykh al-Islam. Just like the scholars accused him in their fatwa. They said he has tempered the quotations of Shaykh al-Islam and Shaykh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim and Ibn al-Qayyim and this and this and this. This is what they do. And then he says, he quotes Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, saying, no doubt that anyone who does not believe that the rule of Allah is a must, then he is a kafir. So he who thinks it's halal, it's okay to rule amongst the people with what he sees as justice without following what Allah has revealed, then he is a kafir. Now, this statement says that if the ruler believes it's okay to rule with other than the rule of Allah, he's a kafir, right? But does it say that he does not become a kafir except when he believes that the rule with other than the rule of Allah is okay? It doesn't say this. So they change the statement to the second one. Yani the Sheikh here is saying, if you rule with other than the rule of Allah, thinking that it's okay to do this, you become a kafir. This is true, consensus of the Muslims. But this is not the same as saying, kufr from the ruler does not occur except by this, to believe that it's okay. Okay? And they say this is a consensus of the Muslims. This is not the saying of any Muslim, let alone a consensus. This is not, because kufr is five types. The belief is one only. And then you have other forms. I'raad, as we mentioned, istikbar, nifaq. So it's not only one. So it's not only takdeeb, denial of the rule of Allah. No. Shaykh al-Islam says, kufr could occur by takdeeb and other than takdeeb. And he mentioned shak, he mentioned this, i'raad, he mentioned nifaq. Okay. And he says, Shaykh al-Islam, if kufr only occurs by takdeeb, if kufr is takdeeb, then iman is tasdeeq. Because iman is opposite to kufr. So if you say kufr is just takdeeb, then iman is just tasdeeq. Then you are a jahmi. You are a follower of jahm in faith, not of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Not even of a follower of Murji'at al-Fuqaha, like Abu Hanifa and others. No. You are a follower of jahm. And they say this. And when you tell them you are, by this, you are following jahm, oh, they'll fire at you. What can you do? They say faith decreases until very, 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 very little remains. This destroys your statement that faith decreases. Because something which decreases, to that small level, how could you say it does not exceed that level? How could you say that? It will exceed it to nothing, right? So faith decreases until there is nothing of it. Not until there is a very, 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 very. And they say, anyone who says that a person who says by tongue, of course, La ilaha illallah, becomes a kafir by not acting upon anything in religion, they say he's from Khawarij. He has some form of Khawarijiyya in him. Then all Ahl-Sunnah are Khawarij, if this is the definition, you know. Ahl-Sunnah say something which is not contradictory. They say something which is clear and right. Okay. Now they say, we say that Iman yazidu wa yanqus. No, you don't say, akhi. You are not saying it. You think you are saying it. But so did people before. Shaykh al-Islam mentions in his time, great scholars, he says they have good intentions, they are pious people, and they think they are following the Salaf. But unfortunately, they are not. That time, in the matters of Iman, he said they have great love for the Salaf and Ahlul Hadith and this, and they think they are following them, but they are not. Okay, Shaykh al-Islam says this, من حلل الحرام المجمع عليه أو حرم الحلال المجمع عليه أو بدل الشرع المجمع عليه فقد كفر اتفاقا. He who makes something which is by the consensus of the nation halal makes it haram, or the opposite, something by the consensus of the nation is haram, makes it halal. Or, this is the third, changes the religion of Allah, which is agreed upon. Changes the shara' which is agreed upon. Part of the religion of Allah. Changes it. Look, Shaykh al-Islam has made changing it equal to making the haram halal and making the halal haram. He said three things. من حلل الحرام المجمع عليه. This is one. أو حرم الحلال المجمع عليه. This is two. أو بدل الشرع المجمع عليه. He made this تبديل different than those two. And then he said, he who does any of those three, he has made great kufr according to the ijma of the nation. بالاتفاق. According to the consensus of the Muslims. Then he goes to the verse, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَكُمْ أَنْزَى اللَّهِ, and he mentioned that the ruler who rules with other the rule of Allah, thinking that it is halal, he is a kafir. And he said this is one of the explanations of the verse. The other explanation is anyone who makes with other than the rule of Allah is a kafir, regardless of he says it's halal or not. Huh? But in the beginning he said, he who changes the shara of Allah, he is like making something halal haram and making haram halal, because he put them into like this, three, which is very clear. And this goes along with what we mentioned earlier when he said, فَهَذَا لَوْنٌ آخر, this is a different kind. When he mentioned the qadiyya and the general rule, he said, وَهَذَا لَوْنٌ آخر, this is different. And those people nowadays still lie to their followers and lie to others and say, no, Shaykh al-Islam, not only Shaykh al-Islam, but all scholars of al-Sunnah say that no kufr without istihlal. This is completely false. So Shaykh Saleh al-Fawzan says that Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah made a distinction between the partial rule, which does not repeat, and between the general rule, which is taken as the reference in all rulings or most of the rulings. And he made it clear that this is great kufr, which takes someone out of the religion. This is what Shaykh al-Fawzan has understood from Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And this is clear, because he who puts aside the Islamic Sharia and makes it the general law other than the Sharia of Allah, then this is a sign that he thinks that the qanun, the man-made laws, is better than the Sharia. This is a sign. Alas, you don't need to go into his heart. You cannot go into his heart. Huh? You cannot go into his heart unless you have hallucination that you think that you can go into his heart. You cannot go into his heart. You can only see his action. Huh? Then the next chapter is also about the ruling with the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, "Iddi'a haqq al-tashri' wa al-tahlil wa al-tahrim," to claim the right of making legislation and making things halal and haram. He put this by itself because it is very dangerous and it is very common also. You know, those parliaments, they call them majalis tashri'iyya. They call them majalis tashri'iyya. Tashri'. Tashri' means to legislate. So they consider those parliaments as a place where the people there who are sitting, who are chosen by the people, huh? Just because he is from such and such a tribe, or just because you believed his banners and think that he's gonna make you a king in one day if you vote for him and things like that. People who are ignorant about the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they gather and they vote. Okay, how about selling wine in the hotels, first of all? And they start with the hotels. How about making it lawful? How many agree? How many agree? 10? Okay. 10. And 9 disagree. Okay, so it's okay, it's lawful. This is very dangerous. And not only in parliaments, but also on boards everywhere now. You have votings and this and that. Every ignorant has become in a position where he has the right to make the halal haram and make the haram halal. This is very bad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to him belongs all the creation and all the rule. أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ. This is the position of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not our position. We can legislate in things which do not contradict Quran and Sunnah. That's okay. You know, how many lashes should we give the person who breaks the red light, for example? These are man-made rules, but they don't contradict Quran and Sunnah. Okay, you can do this. And you have to make a distinction also between such kind of rules and the rules which have a relation to the book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have some people, some enthusiastic people, who doesn't even make this distinction. They consider any kind of legislation to be great kufr, which is an extreme. Now, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us, like in Surah An-Nisa, verse 59, to refer to Allah and His Messenger, and in Surah Ash-Shura, verse 10, to refer to Allah and His Messenger, and in verse 21 from Surah Ash-Shura, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Or do they have partners, rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who make rulings for them besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So it's a form of shirk, because shirk is rival to Allah, a partner. So anyone who accepts any legislation which opposes to the rule of Allah, then he has committed great shirk. And whatever Allah and His Messenger legislate are the legislations that we must accept, and any other thing is an innovation. The Prophet ﷺ said, anyone who introduces in our matter something not from it, then it is rejected. This is narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. And the other hadith, he who acts upon an action which we are not upon, then it is rejected. This is also in Muslim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has called anything which differs from the rule of Allah to be the rule of Jahiliyyah. This is in verse 50, Surah Al-Ma'idah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about obeying the shaitan in making halal haram and making haram halal, he says, وَإِنْ أَطَعْتُمُوهُمْ إِنَّكُمْ لَمُشْرِكُونَ. If you were to obey them, you will become mushriks. This is verse 121, Surah Al-An'am. So it is very clear also then the verse اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم, which is verse 31, Surah At-Tawbah. And he mentioned the story about Adi ibn Hatim that we mentioned earlier. Then the Sheikh says, finally, if this is were to be true for the scholars and the worshippers, that you could be worshipping them by following their orders, which make the halal haram or opposite or vice versa, then how about following the man-made rules which are made by kafirs, atheists, or ignorance, which are brought to the Muslims' countries and made as a rule? فَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد. A very important addition, when Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan said that for someone to substitute the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with man-made laws and make them as general rule for the people, he's kafir, he's out of Islam. This is a general ruling. When it comes to specific rulers, then the scholars give fatwa according to the detailed situation of that individual ruler. When they say that ruling in such a way is great kufr, they don't mean that every person now who is ruling in such a way is necessarily out of Islam. They say that for us to decide about certain individuals, the ruler of this country or that country, we have to see the details of that ruler, what situation he is in. He could be forced. Things could be vague to him, not knowing that he is ruling with other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some scholars who do not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could come to a ruler and tell him that if you rule with such and such rule, then you are ruling with the rule of Allah. Then in this case, we do not declare all the rulers that rule the Muslim countries nowadays with other than the rule of Allah, we do not declare them kafirs. This is not meant by Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan. As a matter of fact, I have a tape by Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan in which he is asked about the rulers in some countries who rule with other than the rule of Allah. They told him, what about those rulers? He said, those rulers, they rule with the man-made law. So this is great kufr. But regarding them as individuals, we must understand their situation more thoroughly. And he said, we don't know that yet about them. So, for example, you tell me such and such person, he's a ruler. I tell you, give me all the details. Let's go and ask him or get some information from some trustworthy person regarding him and something like that. In other words, the general ruling against those kinds of rulers is one thing, and to declare each one of them individually as a kafir is another thing. This is very important. Now, we say this because in the issue of ruling with other than the rule of Allah, when someone is ruling with other than the rule of Allah, then it could be that he is a kafir in his heart also, and it could be that he is not a kafir. But in the case of someone who is supplicating to the wali or cussing at Allah and his messenger clearly, then we cannot imagine that what he is doing or what he is saying is separate from what's in his heart. This is the difference. Is that clear? Because some people tell you, if you tell them, I don't declare this ruler in particular to be a kafir because I need to know more details about him. Okay? Or take it to the scholars. They are the ones who decide, not me and not any student of knowledge. Okay? And not any people who is half-half in knowledge. No, take it to the scholars. Okay? They decide. It's a fatwa. It's not my position to give a fatwa. It's not my position to give you a fatwa in an onion. So you want me to give you a fatwa in declaring a person, a human being, kafir or not? It's not my position. You go to the scholars. Okay? But if I see someone supplicating to other than Allah, I don't need to go to a scholar. It's very clear for me. He's a kafir. I say it. Even if I see a million people in front of me supplicating to other than Allah, I declare the kafirs if they are living in Muslim countries. But if they are living in hidden caves in Africa or places where knowledge cannot be reached, then I say no. They are not kafirs until we establish the proof against them. But the situation is different here, you see, between the ruler and the one who supplicates to the awliya or curses Allah or curses the messenger or steps on Quran purposely, you know. This is clear. This is kufr. I don't need a fatwa for this. Okay? But regarding the rule, I need a fatwa. And not only a fatwa, but a fatwa from the scholars. They are the ones. And not any scholar. The scholar whom we know and it's agreed upon that he's a scholar. Not any idiot or ignorant who declares himself a scholar, you know. And ignorance like him make him a scholar. So we have thousands of those people. Also, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, is of the same opinion of Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan. No difference. Regarding the general ruling, he considers the one who rules with the man-made laws to be kafirs. Regarding individual rulers, he says, يُنظر في كل حال على حدة. Every case is taken individually, separately, and looked into thoroughly. When they asked him, he said this. And the ignorance, the followers of Halabi and those people, they lie on behalf of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. They say that his new madhab, his latest madhab, is that he doesn't declare those who rule with other than the rule of Allah kafirs, except if they believe it is halal. This is the madhab of ignorance. This is not even the madhab of any scholar. This is the madhab of ignorance. To say that a ruler does not become a kafir except by istihlal. This is the madhab of ignorance, pure ignorance okay? And this is very dangerous madhab. To say kufr only occurs by denial is just equal to say that faith is only tasdeeq. And this is the madhab of Jahm. This is very dangerous. Now, these kinds of issues involve believing some of the unseen, of course. There is a difference between believing that this person knows the unseen absolutely. This is great kufr, shirk. But if you go to a person, a fortune teller, and believe him in a certain matter, not believing that he knows the unseen completely, this is not great kufr, but it's still kufr, small kufr. And it's still haram. It's a great sin. So to go through those things in the newspaper that are called zodiac signs, these are all forms of small shirk. If someone goes and believes in this, this is a great sin. And it is something that weakens the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and weakens the faith. And also gradually builds fearing other than Allah like fearing Allah, which is great shirk. So this gradually leads to great shirk. And it also gradually builds in the heart to desire from other than Allah what should not be desired except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this also great shirk. Those which contain the Quran, there is a dispute amongst the scholars. Some scholars say that this is not shirk, and some of them even say it is only makruh but not haram. But the other scholars say it is haram because in matters of tamimas, or the things which are hung on the person, the Prophet ﷺ did not make any exclusion. He made a general statement against tamima. مَنْ تَعَلَّقَ تَمِيمَةً فَقَدْ أَشْرَكْ. But in regards to recitation, okay, not by hanging anything, but recitation or reading, the Prophet ﷺ made distinctions. He said, if you recite from Quran, if you recite what he told us, some words, that's okay. Case of what's hung, like the piece of leather or whatever, even if it is a small stone, jinn, whatever it is, this is all shirk, small shirk. Unfortunately, we have people nowadays, because of their ignorance and fear, they consider anything to be sihr, okay? Some of them might consider hidik to be sihr. This is not what is meant. But if a person changes abruptly and truly, and other people witness this change, not only he himself imagines or hallucinates because of fear, you know, but other people also witness it and see it, then he knows that some kind of sihr has been done to him. Of course, before thinking that it is sihr, he should go to the doctor, and the doctor should see him. And if the doctor doesn't find any reasonable thing, but he is still sure that he is facing such and such things, and there are witnesses to this, and then it is sihr, nothing else. It also could be from an evil eye, an evil look, as they call it, not only sihr. Yeah. Or the acts of shayateen, you know, that might harm him. Maybe because he harmed them in a way which he did not know, or something like that. Those people who go and sit near the grave so that the knowledge from the engraved will enter them, or something like that, this is great shirk. Okay? They call it fuyud. Fuyud means benefits or bundles of knowledge and bundles of barakah and blessings, and this comes to them from the engraved. This is great shirk, because this source of knowledge and blessings is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not from anyone else. And even though they don't believe, as they claim, that this engraved has any quality of lordship, he doesn't create, he doesn't provide, but they still have a belief that he could transfer knowledge to them. This is not done by any human, no human, you see. Yeah, of course, seeking the blessings or seeking this kind of knowledge from him involves shirk in uluhiyya at least. One has to avoid the places where there are ignorant people worshipping that grave, you know, except if he wants to go for giving them nasiha. And this is great jihad. We miss this a lot. We have to make this kind of jihad. But other than that, if he wants to go just for himself, he should not go to such graves. There are a lot of graves which are not taken as places of worship. They are just graves. So you go there, and you remember the hereafter, you remember that you will be in the grave, and so on. Just like that. It softens the heart, and you benefit by reminding yourself of the hereafter. And you also make dua for that person, so that Allah forgives him. Well, for women, there is a controversy. Some scholars say it is haram, because Prophet ﷺ cursed those women who visit the graves. And some scholars say it is not haram because this was abrogated. This was before abrogation that they were cursed. So if the woman can control themselves and not cry loudly and do certain actions which show a kind of protest to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's okay for them to go, inshallah. As long as they don't go in a way where they are a means of seduction for men, yani. They don't go with their faces uncovered or their heads uncovered, or they have perfume on, or they have certain kinds of attractive dresses and things like that. They should go in a modest way. Yani.
Walking the religion from the Sunnah. You said that there were some companions who were making fun.
Yeah, the
some
verse was revealed
at
the time of companions. Not true. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. How could they be believers? بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ, after you were believers. So how could Allah says بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ when they were hypocrites? Not true. And also they came and strongly apologized to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Like individually?
In your aqidah first, in your faith. You take it from the book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger ﷺ, the books which are supported by the proofs. In your Salat, you don't just take your Salat from traditions. You try your best to take it from scholars, and better than that, to take it with the proofs from Quran and Sunnah. Even if you take it from scholars, you still go and study the proofs. But in the case of Aqidah, you have to go and study the proofs. You will be sinning if you don't. You see? Your Aqidah, if it's true, will be accepted, even if it's taken by taqlid, by blind following. As long as it is true, it is accepted. But it's a must on you to seek the proofs, the minimum at least, to have surety in the heart, yaqeen, for Aqidah. But in Salat, Siyam, Hajj, Zakat, your treatment for your wife, your treatment for your children, if you deal with buying and selling, you go and study the rules of Sharia regarding buying and selling. You see, Umar radiallahu anhu was going in the markets and seeing those people who buy and sell and make sure that they know the Sharia for this. If they don't know, he would make them learn it. So whatever you want to do, any obligation that you have to do, you should learn the Sharia for it. Alhamdulillah, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna nabiyyina Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taslima. Last time, the Sheikh, His Honor, the great scholar, Salih al-Fawzan, in his book Kitab al-Tawheed, in chapter 6, towards the end, he mentioned a summary saying that he who puts aside the Islamic Sharia and refers instead to the man-made law, then this is a proof that he finds the man-made law to be better and more suitable than the Sharia. And this is, with no doubt, is great kufr, which takes someone out of Islam and contradicts Tawheed totally. The next chapter, also about the ruling, in chapter 7, the Sheikh says, as a title, to claim the right of legislation and of making things halal or haram. The legislation that the people follow, whether in their worships or in their dealings or in any other matter of their matters, is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the people and the creator of the creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to him belongs the creation and the rule or the order. Blessed be Allah, the Lord of the universe, or the Lord of the worlds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indeed knows what is better for his worshippers. So he legislates that which is better for them because of his lordship. And he legislates for them not just because of his lordship for them, but because of their slavery to him and their worship to him. He is their Lord, therefore the right of ruling is to him. And they are his slaves and worshippers, and therefore they should accept his ruling. And the advantage comes back to mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you were to dispute about something, take it back to Allah and the Messenger. If you were faithful in Allah and the Day of Judgment, that is better and more suitable for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whatever you differ in, you should take it to the ruling of Allah. That is Allah, our Lord. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the mushriks, do they have companions or rivals that they refer to in legislation, who legislate for them their religion? They legislate for them that which Allah did not permit or does not permit. So anyone who accepts a legislation other than the legislation of Allah, then he has set a rival with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, set a companion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not legislate, or the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not legislate, then it is an innovation. And every innovation is a going astray, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the true hadith. And he said in another hadith, he who acts an action which is not from our action, then it is rejected. And also, whatever Allah did not legislate or the Messenger did not legislate, whether in politics and rulings amongst people, then this is the ruling of Taghut and the ruling of Jahiliyyah, the time of ignorance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ, or do they want the ruling of Jahiliyyah? وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حُكْمًا لِقَوْمٍ يُوقِنُونَ, who is to be better than Allah in his ruling for the people who are sure in their faith about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So from this verse, it is clear that every ruling other than the ruling of Allah and his Messenger is the ruling of Jahiliyyah, if it is different from the ruling of Allah and his Messenger, or contradicts the ruling of Allah and his Messenger. Similarly, the action of making things halal or haram, is an absolute right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one should be taken as a companion to Allah in that action of making things halal or haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, do not eat that which the name of Allah has not been mentioned upon, and it is fisq. And the devils whisper to their friends or to their allies so that they argue with you regarding this. And if you were to obey them in this, then you would be mushriks. You would be described as mushriks, sitting rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the devils and their allies, when they make what Allah made haram, they make it halal. He made this shirk, that is setting up rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh says, similarly, those who obey the scholars and the rulers in what they make haram or halal from themselves, they have taken them as lords besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah said, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا إلها واحدا لا إله إلا هو سبحانه عما يشركون. Meaning, they have taken their rabbis and monks as lords besides Allah. They similarly did with Jesus, the son of Maryam. They took him as a lord besides Allah. And they were not ordered but to worship one God. No one is worthy of being worshipped but him. Glory be to him from that which they ascribe to him as partners. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, upon reciting this verse, he explained it to Adi ibn Hatim al-Ta'i, who was a Christian priest before becoming a Muslim. And Adi ibn Hatim, when he heard this verse from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he thought that worshipping the rabbis and monks meant to pray to them, to supplicate to them, things like that. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam explained to him that indeed this is part of worshipping them, but this is not all what the word worshipping rabbis and monks and scholars means. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told Adi ibn Hatim, weren't they, meaning your scholars, your monks and rabbis, weren't they making that which Allah made haram, making it halal for them? And the opposite also, that which Allah made halal, they would make it haram for them. Adi said, yes indeed, they were. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, فَتِلْكَ عِبَادَتُهُمْ, that is worshipping them. So it's a form of worshipping. And of course, this, as Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has shown, this is on two levels, not one level. For someone to obey the scholar, believing that what he ordered him is true, even though he knows that it is against the Book of Allah and Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, then this is great kufr. It will take him out of Islam. To believe it is true, knowing that it's against the Book of Allah and the Sunnah, then this is great kufr. The second level is a sin. It's not kufr. That is to obey the ruler or whoever it might be, not believing that what he ordered him is true, but just using that order as an excuse for him or just as a justification for his action. And he knows in his heart that this is wrong and that Allah's ruling regarding this issue is the truth and nothing else is the truth. So in this case, this is a sin. This was explained by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah in his books regarding this verse. The Shaykh says, finally, So how about those who obey the rulings of the man-made law that has been made by the kafirs and by the atheists? So someone would bring them to the Muslim countries and make those laws as the rule amongst Muslims. فَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. That this is something the Sheikh is saying about لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ, which is an expression of denial to this great thing and putting it in a way that this is a very bad thing, a very ugly action to bring man-made laws, not even by Muslims, but by kafirs and atheists, and set them as the reference and as the laws in the Muslim countries. This is indeed a very ugly kufr and a very ugly action.